My name is Hayden King. I'm the director of the Center for Indigenous Governance at Ryerson University. I'm also an assistant professor of politics at Ryerson. We have a very long history of treaty making, right? Before settlers arrived, Indigenous peoples were making treaties with each other. We were making treaties with the land for Anishinaabek people. Treaties with the land were some of our first formal agreements that I think you could describe today or characterize today as a treaty. And we made treaties with Haudenosaunee people. Haudenosaunee people made treaties throughout the Great Lakes. So treaty making has been a very old feature of Indigenous diplomacy. And then, of course, I think misunderstanding really starts to seep into the notion of treaty when settlers do arrive and we do begin to make treaties. And of course, Indigenous peoples have maintained the principles of treaty making that they started since time immemorial with those new settlers. So, you know, treaties were agreements of peace, friendship, setting out our respective obligations and responsibilities to each other, ensuring that the land was spoken for. Also sacred pacts. You know, these were not taken lightly, but ultimately treaties for Indigenous peoples were long-term peace and friendship pacts, sharing agreements for how to live with each other on the land. And when settlers came, I think that they viewed treaties as very transactional. So we're coming, we're essentially buying a lease on the land that we can exploit, we can consume and use the resources and move on. And so that is a very transactional way of looking at what for Indigenous peoples was much more about a relationship with each other, a relationship to the land. So I think that's a clash of worldviews that really emerged in the early mid-1600s and certainly is a feature of the relationship today. The settler perspective, the Canadian perspective or American perspective of treaties is the one that has been privileged, right? So it is generally non-Indigenous peoples that have written history textbooks. It is generally non-Indigenous peoples that have analyzed treaties from a historical perspective. It is generally non-Indigenous judges that make decisions on the validity and contents of a treaty. And all of those non-Indigenous peoples are couched in a particular way of viewing the world. You know, a lot of that has to do with the written version of treaties, which holds a lot of power for those who are part of the written tradition. And of course, Indigenous peoples are through assimilation today, and it's something that we're very much involved in and with. But through time, as our relationship has evolved and as treaties have been interpreted, that one particular vision has been privileged, and that has marginalized Indigenous perspectives on treaties. And so I think that that's primarily why we have this tremendous misunderstanding, and primarily why Canadians really seem to view treaties as these sort of one-time transactional agreements that allow them to come and settle and exploit the land, and forgot about the long-term political, economic relationship that treaties were supposed to inform. The settler perspective, the Canadian perspective or American perspective of treaties is the one that has been privileged, right? So it is generally non-Indigenous peoples that have written history textbooks. It is generally non-Indigenous peoples that have analyzed treaties from a historical perspective. It is generally non-Indigenous judges that make decisions on the validity and contents of a treaty. And all of those non-Indigenous peoples are couched in a particular way of viewing the world. You know, a lot of that has to do with the written version of treaties, which holds a lot of power for those who are part of the written tradition. And of course, Indigenous peoples are through assimilation today, and it's something that we're very much involved in and with. But through time, as our relationship has evolved and as treaties have been interpreted, that one particular vision has been privileged, and that has marginalized indigenous perspectives on treaties. And so I think that that's primarily why we have this tremendous misunderstanding, and primarily why Canadians only really seem to view treaties as these sort of one-time transactional agreements that allow them to come and settle and exploit the land, and forgot about the long-term friendship, peace, friendship, political, economic relationship that treaties are supposed to inform. I think often people think of treaties as being ancient history, right? That they're old, that they're, you know, that they're they were before Confederation, and I think that that doesn't appreciate the fact that there are a variety of treaty making eras. You know, there's the pre-Confederation treaty making era, often led by Indigenous peoples. There's the numbered treaties and the Robinson treaties, the Confederation era treaties. There's the blank treaties of Upper and Lower Canada, and of course now there's modern treaties. Comprehensive land claims. So treaties are kind of diverse as you go through history, and they aren't a stuck in time or static. They're constantly evolving, constantly changing. And the thing about treaties is that they lay the foundation for relationships on the land. So it doesn't matter if the treaty was made in 1870 or 1921. Or 1999 or 2016, that the treaty sets out the roles and responsibilities for individuals in relation to each other and on the land. And it does, and people come to Canada all the time. People come to Canada by virtue of the fact that the treaty exists. If treaties did not exist, newcomers would not be able to come and settle this land. That's what Canadians got out of the treaty bargain. So newcomers, new Canadians that are coming to Canada, they're benefiting from treaties. They are able to come here and work and live and have children and families and friendships, and all of that is made possible by treaties. And so, you know, the other side of that agreement is the obligation. So what do Canadians generally and newcomers, you know, what are their obligations in the treaty relationship? I think often new Canadians just think of coming to this wonderful new place that is Canada without realizing what their responsibilities are to Indigenous peoples. And so I think we have to have broader and more thorough discussions about how we can ensure that the treaty relationship is honored moving forward into the future. The Dish with One Spoon, I'm not even sure I would describe The Dish with One Spoon as a treaty. I think it really evolved more as a metaphor, as a symbol. The Dish with One Spoon, the dish, it represents Southern Ontario, what's now Southern Ontario, the Great Lakes. And what's inside the dish is the land, the creatures that we share it with, the resources. And when we come to agreement as distinct peoples, whether it's Haudenosaunee people and Anishinaabeg people, which were the original signatories to the Dish with One Spoon Treaty, we recognize that we have obligations to each other, but we also have obligations to the land, you know, to ensure that the dish never goes empty, right? So the Dish with One Spoon, we all live in the dish, we all benefit and are able to live and work on the contents of the dish, but so it's our obligation to make sure that dish never goes dry. And of course, there's a spoon on the wampum. There are no sharp objects, no knives, no forks with which we can stab each other. So this is a peace agreement. And I think the Dish with One Spoon is a really, you know, is a really powerful metaphor for our ancestors and their relationship with Haudenosaunee people. And then the Haudenosaunee people extended it to their allies and their friends. We did the same. And it has been renegotiated many years, many times over the years, and I think it's really powerful today as well to say to people, you know, you're coming into our territory, you're coming into the Dish with One Spoon territory, and these are your obligations coming into this land. You have to make sure that the dish never runs dry. You have to make sure not to bring out your knives at the table. So I think that its power is enduring in that sense. To be honest with you, I'm kind of tired of hearing that we are all treaty people, because it's said as such a hollow refrain. You know, we hear the premier say it all the time, and you know, we're all treaty people. But unless we're actually going to have a serious conversation about what treaties mean and what our obligations are to each other and all the awful things that have been done throughout treaty history, like the continued misinterpretation of those treaties. You know, we can't say that we're all treaty people. You know, we are actively breaking treaties. We're actively breaking our obligations to each other and to the land. So what does that mean for our relationship? You know, does that mean that all settlers have to leave? Does it mean that the land is no longer going to tolerate us? I think that those are really important questions to ask. So when I hear that refrain, we are all treaty people, I want to believe that, yes, we are all treaty people, and yes, we have those obligations. And I want to believe that future is possible. But right now, we're very bad treaty people. And so we need to critically think about that, you know, we're all treaty people. Because if we're not talking about the actual obligations required to be treaty people, then for me, it's just completely hollow.